thanks for being here. So this is the last session of the day for this track, I guess. So I guess you're pretty tired by now. So thanks for being here. So this talk is going to be about monadic parser combinators with TypeScript. I don't know if you know something about the topic already. Does anyone know about TypeScript or parser combinators or something like that? Okay, cool. So a little introduction first. My name is Simone Busoli. I'm Italian, as you can hear probably. I'm a freelance software engineer, or at least I like to call myself one in the sense that I'm an engineer at work, and I work with software. I don't necessarily apply engineering practices to software, assuming they even exist. So you can find a bit more information about me on the website of the conference, and you can see here a link to my GitHub profile if you're interested. Feel free to get in touch. Okay, so this talk is about TypeScript and writing parsers with TypeScript. Has anyone used TypeScript before? Okay, some people actually. So TypeScript, for those who don't know it, is a programming language, as you can imagine. It's a programming language by Microsoft, but it's open source, don't worry. So this is a screenshot from the website. So TypeScript is basically a typed superset of JavaScript, and it compiles to JavaScript. So being a superset means that any valid JavaScript code is also valid TypeScript code. Okay, and being typed is that, as you know, JavaScript is a dynamically typed language. TypeScript adds some features on top of JavaScript that make it a strongly typed, a statically typed language. So you will have a compiler. And what the compiler does, the TypeScript compiler compiles TypeScript code into JavaScript code. Okay, so this guy that you see here is the creator of TypeScript. His name is Anders Heisberg. He works for Microsoft, of course. And he's also the designer of C#, or at least one of the main designers of C#. So the kind of features that you see in TypeScript are the kind of features that you would somewhat expect from someone who wrote or at least came up with the idea of C#. So static typing, basically. So so in this talk, actually, this is a screenshot from a video that you can find on the website of TypeScript. And I encourage you to watch it, because it's quite interesting. And one of the things that it says is the rationale behind the language. So what it thinks, you can share it or not, is that writing complex applications with JavaScript is difficult. It's difficult because it's a dynamically typed language. And you don't have the support of a compiler to at least catch some basic errors, at least errors that pertain typing. Okay, so that's the rationale behind TypeScript. So my idea for this talk came from these two papers. There's a link behind the image, so I encourage you to read them because they're quite interesting. The first is a functional parser, and the second one is monadic parser combinators. They are from the same authors. They are not difficult at all to read. I really encourage you to read them. They're quite interesting, and especially they also show sample code in Haskell, so that you can also compare it to TypeScript, to the implementations that we'll see later. And yeah, that's basically it. And this guy is one of the authors of these two papers. He's a former Microsoft employee as well. So Eric Meyer is a fancy guy, as you can see from the picture. He likes to wear this kind of t-shirts. But he's also one of the guys who created interesting stuff in the .NET framework. So if you have used C# or VB.NET or other languages which run on the .NET platform, you may have heard of Link and reactive extensions. He's one of the guys behind these ideas, which are quite cool, by the way. Okay. So, what is a parser? So, let's delve into the topic. These are a few examples in Haskell. We won't see much Haskell code, actually. I'm showing this now just because we'll see examples later. But basically, a parser, as you can see here, is basically a function which takes a string and returns something which represents the parse string, which you can represent as a tree structure. So, actually, the idea is that a parser does not necessarily parse the entire string that it is given as the input. So you can see in the second line an alternative implementation, which besides returning a tree, returns also a string. That's a tuple, and the second item of the tuple, which is a string, is the part of the string which has not been parsed by the parser. Okay, so that's the second improvement over the first one. So the next step that we can do is that we can actually return an array of results. Okay. So rather than returning just a tuple containing in the first item a tree and in the second item a string, we can return an array of them. The reason behind this is that a parser can be able of parsing an ambiguous grammar. So an ambiguous grammar is a grammar which can be parsed in multiple ways. So rather than just returning a single result represented by the tuple and the second line, we can return an array of results in the third line. Finally, in the fourth line, we can see that we basically come up with generic implementation. So rather than returning a static structure, a tree, we can actually parameterize it on the type A. Okay, so this is Haskell. Let's see what it looks like, or it can possibly look like in TypeScript. Okay, so I'm repeating the last implementation that we see in the Haskell code, which is the first example. And in the second sample, you see the implementation that I came up with in TypeScript code. So let's have a look at what it looks like. So first of all, we can see that we are using an interface, which is not something that someone familiar with JavaScript would see normally. So you don't have interfaces in JavaScript. TypeScript introduces interfaces. So I came up with an interface iParser. And besides being an interface, it's also a generic interface. So it's a generic over the parameter A. So it's something that you probably are used to seeing in languages like C# or Java, probably. OK, the other interesting thing is that what this interface defines is not actually an interface with members, methods, or properties, but rather a function call. So someone implementing or getting a handle over this interface gets actually something that it can call. Okay, and the function call, the signature, is actually what we saw before. So it takes a string and returns an array of results. Again, this is also something not quite common to see in JavaScript, because the array of results is actually an array of tuples. So the syntax is a bit misleading, because it looks like an array of arrays, but it's actually not an array of arrays in TypeScript, because it's an array of tuples. So A is the first item of the tuple, so a variable of type A, a value of type A, and string is the second item of the tuple. So the result of parsing a string is actually an array of tuples, the same thing that we have in Haskell, basically. Okay. So this is just the interface of a parser. We can come up with a primitive parser, which we call item. So item is a parser which can parse a single character from a string. Okay? So the implementation is pretty simple. You see, again, examples both in Haskell and TypeScript. So item is a parser which takes a string and parses a single character from a string, whatever it is. The result is, of course, if the string is not empty, otherwise it returns an empty array of results. But otherwise, it parses it, and its result type is the first character of the string, and the second item of the resulting tuple is the remainder of the string. So this is the first primitive parser that we can use, and you see an example usage here. So this is a unit test written in a common unit testing framework for JavaScript, which is called Jasmine. You may be familiar with the syntax already; should be fairly readable, I guess. So we basically parse the string hello with the item parser, and we expect the result to be one. And we see that actually the result, the first item of the results array, is a tuple containing the string h in the first item and the string hello without the h in the second item, which is the remainder of the string. Okay, but is this simple parser, primitive parser, useful? By itself, not really, because if you want to parse a complex grammar, we cannot use these simple parsers. So we have to come up with a way to combine them. And the way to combine them is actually to write combinators. Okay, so we can come up with a simple combinators, so a combinator called sec, S-E-Q. So combinators, as you can see on the slide, are basically high-order functions that implement grammar constructions as sequencing, choice, or repetition. In this case, our example implements sequencing. So the sec parser is a parser combinator which takes two parsers and combines the result as an array. Okay, you can see an example below. So basically, we are sequencing together two item parsers, so the same kind of parser. And what it does is puts gives the string hello as input to the first parser, so the first item parser, and then gives the remainder of the string, so hello without h, to the second item parser, and combines the results together. So the final result is a single singleton array, where the result is the array h and d, and the remainder of the string is llo. So how would we go about implementing such a combinator? So again, you can see an example, both in Haskell and TypeScript. And I'm not going to go through the implementation, because as you can see, it's fairly convoluted, especially because it's not what you would do usually. So this code actually implements the behavior that we have seen, but there are better ways to implement parser combinators. And the way to implement better parser combinators is to use monads applied to parsers. So, monads to the rescue. So monads are an abstract concept. I'm not probably the best person to talk about them, but you can see what a monad would look like, actually what it looks like in Haskell, and what it may look like in TypeScript. So I came up again with an interface, and a monad is basically a structure which has two functions, normally called unit and bind. Unit is also called a times return, but in JavaScript, return is a reserved keyword, so I could not use it here. So you can see the signatures here, not implementation. So basically, the unit function is a function which takes a value of type A and returns a monad of type A. Whereas bind is another function which takes a monad of type A, a function which takes a value of type A and returns a monad of type B, and its return type is a monad of type B. I know it might be not really, if you're not familiar at least with monads, it might not be really straightforward to understand what's going on, but we'll try to clear it up later. Okay, so this is the abstract concept of monads. Also, bear in mind that the implementation of these two functions is not random. You have to implement that properly because they have to respect some laws. So the parser monad is a special kind of monads. There are many kinds of monads, and the parser monad is just one of them. So we can see the implementation here. Actually, this is not really implementation that I use in my sample code that we can see later, but just to give you the idea how we would implement the unit and the bind functions. So basically, the unit function is a function which takes a value of type A and just returns a parser, which doesn't consume any of its input string, but just resolves the value that it is given. So you can see that A goes straight into the first item of the tuple, which is returned as a result. Bind is a bit more complex. I can understand it might not be straightforward to follow this code, but I'll try to explain it worse. And then we can see also a visual representation later. So what bind does is basically apply the first parser it is given, so the parser P in the example, to the input string. What we get back is an array, possibly an array of results, of multiple results. And being as a function which takes a value of type A and return a parser of type B, we can call this function with each item returned from the application of the first parser P. And finally, we concat the results together, because otherwise we would have a nested array of results. And we want instead a plain and non-nested array of results. We'll see later what it looks like. So I'm just showing him some support classes that I'm using. I'm defining again another interface parser, which extends iParser. So we have an interface which extends an interface. Don't forget that iParser was actually a function signature, so it didn't have any members. It was just a function signature that you can call. So a nice thing about interfaces in TypeScript is that you can do this kind of stuff that you wouldn't usually be able to do in other languages. The interface parser extends this interface by giving it a member called bind. The reason why I did this, it's actually not a rule, it's just the way that I came up with to implement this concept, is that any parser gets a function bind so that you can use the infix notation to call it, rather than calling it as a pure function. And then I'm just showing the implementation of the concat method, which is just a fancy way in JavaScript to basically flatten a nested array. And that's it. OK, so this is my actual implementation of the parser monad and with its bind function. So I'm creating a function which is called MP, which stands for make parser, which takes a P, which is an implementation of iParser, and returns a parser. So this is fairly strange, I guess, if you haven't used TypeScript before, because I'm basically casting P, which is an iParser, to a parser. So I'm casting a function to something which is supposed to have a bind member, which it doesn't have, at least yet. And then I'm applying it, I'm giving it a bind member, which is exactly the same implementation that we saw before, and then I return it. So we basically, this method allows us to do is basically create a parser from just a function and nothing else. Okay, so using this new implementation of the parser, we can actually redefine the sec combinator that we saw before using a monadic approach, which, as you can see, is much more straightforward than what we used to do before, because it's just basically binding P to Q bind unit. So basically, we are just getting the result of parsing the input string with P, and then we are basically applying the remaining of the string with Q, and then we are combining the results of both applications. So basically, sequencing the two parsers. To give you a better idea of what this looks like, let's see a visual representation of the procedure. So this is basically more or less what is going on. So we start from the string hello, and we give it to the result of combining with a sec combinator, parser item and parse item. So after the first application of the first parser, we get back an array of results where the actual result is H and the remainder of the string is hello without the H in the beginning. Then after we apply the second parser, we get back an array of results. And basically what we do is call concat, which flattens the result. And that's the final result, which is exactly what we expect after sequencing the two parsers. Okay. Besides the sec combinator, which is fairly straightforward, we can define some other combinators which allow us to implement more complex behaviors. Those more complex behaviors actually allow us to implement more complex parser for grammars which are more difficult to parse otherwise. So we can define a plus combinator, which again takes a parser P and takes a parser Q, so takes two parsers of type A and returns another parser of type A. So what the plus combinator does is it applies the input string to the parser P, it applies the same input string to the parser Q, and then concats the result. So we basically see in the example below that we get a result with two items rather than just one, because we applied both parsers to the same input string. And the result is exactly the same for both parsers. So this is the first parser combinator for combining two parsers. And then we have another combinator, which is called plus plus, which is pretty similar to what we saw before, except that, as we saw before, we get two results back. Usually, we are interested in the first result only. So basically, what the plus plus combinator does is extract only the first result after applying the parser, rather than both of them. And you can see the behavior explained in the example below. You can see that basically the result is only one item rather than two. Then we have another combinator, which is called sat. This is a conditional combinator. So what the sat combinator does is it takes a predicate and returns a parser. So what this does actually is that it only parses a string if the first character of the string matches whatever the predicate suggests. So we can see an example below. So basically, we create a sat parser, passing it a number constructor. And when we try to pass the string 1A, we see that the result is 1 because it was passed successfully. And the remainder of the string is A because it was not parsed. OK, using these combinators that we have seen so far, we can create some other combinators, which are a bit simple now that you look at them. So for example, you can define a digit combinator, which is capable of parsing digits. And we create it using the sat combinator, which basically is successful only if the character that it is giving as input is a string between 0 and 9. The same holds true for the lower and upper parsers, implemented pretty much in the same way. And with these three simple parsers, we can implement more complex parsers. For example, the letter parser, which is basically a plus applied to lower and upper. So a letter parser can either parse a lower letter or an uppercase letter. And then we have the alphanumeric parser, which is capable of parsing a letter or a digit. Finally, we have the char parser, which is actually another combinator because it takes a string and returns a parser, which basically parses successfully only if the character string which is given matches the input string applied to the parser. And you can see an example of how it works below. So we create a char parser with an h character, and then when we try to parse a string hello with h lowercase, it parses successfully, whereas when we try to parse the string hello with the uppercase h, it does not parse anything and returns an empty array of results. Okay. So besides these simple parsers and combinators, we can also go further and implement parsers which call themselves recursively. So this is an example of it. You can recall that we basically created a parser which is capable of parsing characters before, so the char parser. Then we can create a parser called string, which besides being able of parsing a single character, is actually capable of parsing an entire string, exactly the string that we give it as an argument when we create it. So basically, you can see an example below. So we create a string parser, parsing it a hello string, and then when we try to parse a string hello word, it parses successfully hello, whereas it doesn't parse word, because the word string does not match the string hello, which is what we used when we constructed it in the first place. We can create some other recursion combinators, and this one is the many-one combinator. So what this does compared to the previous one is that it is capable of parsing the parser that it is given when it is created multiple times. So for example, if we create it using the parser char c, and then we call it with a string ccdd, we can see that it parses successfully two times the character c, and it could parse it successfully as many times as we want. And it does not parse the character D, of course. And we can also see an example of how it fails exactly, because if we try to parse the character D, the result we don't get any result back, basically. Okay, so it is capable of parsing, of applying the same parser, the parser P, multiple times. So we can see another parser which is pretty similar to this, although slightly different, because this parser, which is called many rather than many one, can again apply the parser P multiple times, but it succeeds also if it cannot parse anything from the input string. So that's the only difference between the two. So you can see basically the only difference is in the failing example, because whereas the first parser that we saw before, the many one parser, didn't return any results. So in the second test, the results array was empty. In the other case, the results array is not empty, but it basically succeeds with an empty array of values. Yes, exactly. Because of the way it works, the many, so in this case, so the question is, he's asking why many one is defined in terms of many. Because of the way it works, they don't call themselves recursively. So you can see how it works in the code. The code is attached to the slide, so you can see it on the GitHub repository of the conference, so feel free to have a look at it. So because of the way it works, basically many is actually not called, they don't call themselves recursively, otherwise this would be infinite recursion. Okay, that's a good observation, by the way. But the only difference between the two is that one parses successfully any input string, whereas the other one does not parse successfully any input string. Okay, the other parser combinator that we can come up with is setPy1, which is another interesting parser because it's capable of applying the parser P multiple times, separated by applications of parser P, parser sep, which is a second parser that we give it to the constructor when we create it. So what this does, and you can see an example below, is that if we try to parse the string A1, B2, C3 with a parser, which is created using setPy1, using the letter parser and the digit parser, is that the result is actually an array containing the letters, whereas it does not parse successfully the character. Okay, so we are basically throwing away the numbers, and we are keeping instead the letters. finally, this is the last recursion combinator that we'll see, which is also the most complex and allows us to parse arithmetic expressions, as we see later. So this is basically the chain L1 combinator, which is basically capable of parsing repeated application of P, which is the first parser that we give it as input, separated by applications of parser OP. So parser OP is an interesting parser because, differently from what we saw so far, this is actually a parser which is capable of parsing functions. So the result of applying this parser is a function, is actually a caret function because it takes a parameter A and the parameter B of type A and returns a value of type A. Okay. So this is a parser which is capable of parsing functions. It's a parser which is capable of parsing functions, which are actually assumed because of the way it is called, and you can see it in the implementation. So these functions are assumed to associate to the left, otherwise it wouldn't work. In the same way, you can come up with parsers which parse functions which associate to the right. Okay, so you can see an example below. So we basically apply the parser chain L1 to two combinators, which are the digit, actually enriched so that besides parsing a digit, it also transforms into an integer number. And then we, and the second argument to the constructor of the chain L1 combinator is the unit parser, which is just a function, a plain function, which sums up together whatever it is given as input. Okay, so if we call this parser using the string 123A, we will see that the result is actually 6, which is the sum of 123, of course, and A is the remainder of the string which has not been parsed. Okay. So the parsers that we have seen so far, with some extensions that we are going to see soon, allow us to parse arbitrarily complex grammars. Just by using simple combinators which are chained together using the combinators that we created so far. So for example, we can create lexical combinators for interpreting parts of a simple grammar. And for example, we can create the space combinator, which parses as many spaces as it is given. Then a token combinator, which is basically capable of parsing anything except, ignoring any leading space, any trailing space. And then we have a symbol combinator, which is basically capable of parsing any token which matches the string that is given as input. And finally, the apply combinator, which doesn't do anything except throwing away any leading space and apply the parser P to the string CS that it is given as input. Okay. So using these combinators, we can create, we can implement a parser and also an evaluator, as we will see. There's a question? Yes. Okay, so the question is, what does it mean that a parser OP is capable of parsing function? So what it means is that the result of the parsing is a function. So if you say that this parser is capable of parsing a function, a sum function, you can say that whenever it encounters a plus character, the return value is a function. Okay, we will see that later, but what this means is that the return type of the parser is a function, not that it's capable of parsing a string which contains a function. Okay. Exactly. So the generic argument of a parser is what it returns. What it takes is, as usual for any parser, a string. And the value is what it returns. In this case, we are returning just a function, straight function, but we will see later when we implement the grammar that whenever we encounter a plus, we will return a function which sums number, and so on for the other basic arithmetic operators. So we were looking at our simple standard grammar for arithmetic operations. So this grammar is made of single digits, the usual operators, plus, minus, star for multiplication and division, and brackets as well. Okay. So this is a very simple arithmetic grammar that we can implement with the parser combinators that we created so far. So this is a definition of the other combinators that we need, and we will see the implementations later. But basically, we have an expression, an addition operation, a multiplication operation, a term, a factor, and a numeric digit. Since we are dealing with numbers here, all of these parsers parse numbers. Okay, so we won't see strings anymore. Okay, you'll see that the add operation and multiplication operation have a similar structure to what we saw before. So basically, the return type is a function. So this is the implementation of the addition operation and multiplication operation, which is probably an answer to your question, because you can see that we basically create a parser combinator, which is capable of parsing plus symbols and minus symbols. And the result of parsing such a symbol is a corresponding function, which is basically summing up numbers or subtracting numbers. Okay, this is also fairly similar to the multiplication operation. So again, P plus, just to reiterate, is an operator which is capable of parsing either the first one or the second one, and actually returns only the first results of the successful parsing. And so, yeah, again, with the multiplication operation, we can successfully parse the star symbol, which results in a multiplication operation, or the division symbol, which results in a division operation. Okay, we need some more parsers before we can actually implement a real parser for the grammar that we have seen, which is the numeric digit, which is basically just parsing tokens of type digit, so basically numbers, and convert them using the parsing, the standard parsing function in JavaScript to integers. Then we have factors, which basically is again an application of the P plus combinator using numeric digit and a bracketed expression. So the bracketed expression is pretty interesting because basically it parses a symbol, which is the open left bracket, and it binds it to an expression that we that is defined below, and then it parses a red closing round bracket. Okay, so again, we have again the term combinator and the expression combinator, which are using the chain L1 combinator to successfully parse terms and expressions. So I understand this can look a bit complex to follow just by looking at the code, because it takes actually some time to figure out what's going on, and it's not so simple to follow just by looking at the code. But an example should actually reveal a bit more about what's going on. So basically, if we get the expression parser and try to apply it to the string 1 minus 2 multiplied by 3 minus 1 plus 2, we actually get back what we would expect by summing up and multiplicating and these numbers. So we get minus 1 back, and we don't get any unparsed, unconsumed input string. Okay, so I would like to let you know that what I showed you so far is actually what I came up with TypeScript. My experiment stemmed basically from the idea that writing monadic code is difficult because you would use the help of a compiler, because getting the types right is quite difficult with monadic code. So considering that I write a lot of JavaScript code, I thought it would be interesting to figure out what it would look like to use TypeScript, so a statically typed language, to implement the same monadic code. So what I created is definitely not the state of the art of writing monadic parser combinators with TypeScript or any other languages for that matter. But there are actually libraries that you can look into, and I encourage you to look into them if you are interested. And they are Banjo.js and Parsimon. So these are two JavaScript libraries for creating parser combinators, and they actually come with already fully functional combinators. For example, I show you some code from the Parsimon library. So this code, of course, is not intended for you to read, but just to show you that this is a full JSON parser built using the Parsimon library. So you see it's just a few tens of lines of code, and it's a fully functional JSON parser written in Parsimon, which is using the same principle that we have used so far in the talk to implement our parser combinators. Okay, so it's pretty powerful. Okay, I think this is pretty much all for me. I thank you very much for your attention, especially for the late hour. Of course, if you have any questions, you can ask them now. Otherwise, I don't have anything more to say about the topic. Any questions? Okay, so the question is, are we parsing numbers composed of more than one digit? No, the grammar is pretty simple. So in the definition of the grammar, you can see that, okay, so digit is defined as a single digit number. So we can only ever parse single digits. Of course, it would be possible to parse multiple digits, and as we saw in earlier examples. But in this specific grammar, and I'm actually basically replicating the samples that you can see in the talks of the paper in the papers that I showed you before, they are only parsing single digits. But it would be entirely possible to parse multiple digits by just combining the digit parser using any of the other combinators, using, for example, many or many one. Okay. Well, I would say it's entirely possible. I'm speaking about TypeScript mainly and JavaScript because I'm actually a JavaScript developer. I do mainly JavaScript nowadays. So I would say it's entirely possible to do that. Probably I don't have a clear example in mind. Would you like to like make an example or something like that? Okay. So his question is basically, can I create a parser dynamically? So I just write in a text box some code to create a parser, and then I can interpret that code and create a parser on top of that. Well, it depends on the kind of syntax that you want to use. If you want to use the same syntax that we have seen so far to create parser, I think in JavaScript it's entirely possible because we have some evil functions that can let you eval code at runtime, which is usually not advisable to do, but in this specific case, I think you are completely free to do that. Yes, so I would say yes. Are there any other questions? Okay, so thank you very much, and yeah, I hope you have a great day today.